Oh my god, oh my god, hurry up. Pass me the phone.
Come on, come on, come on.
Oh my god, hi Carrie, it's me, I'm Beauty. And it's Dominique Nicole. You
already know DJ the rapper.
Go ahead, Carrie. Go ahead, Carrie. Go ahead, Carrie. Like it is, boy. Go ahead, carry. Go ahead, carry. Go ahead, carry. Tell it like it is, boy. Go ahead, carry. Go ahead, carry. Go ahead, carry. Tell it like it is, boy. Go ahead, carry. Go ahead, carry. Go ahead, carry. Tell it like it is, boy.
Carry, tell it, break it, this, do your radio. Fully syndicated, funny for the silly folks. Always keep it positive, never negative. And when he start to play the beats, I'ma have to write you up a eulogy, cause they so hot. And I stay live, and I stay woke when the man trying to keep me on demand. Yeah, DJ, Beyond Beauty, and Dominique Nicole did it again, how do you understand?
Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to the Carrie's Corner Radio Show. We are officially deep, well, not deep, but deeper into the month of March. All of our networks are now in the month of March, whereas last week some of us were and some of us weren't. March is my favorite month, not just because it's my birthday, but it's also the anniversary of my book. The Wanderer's Game came out on March 18th, 2013. And even more importantly than my little novel that turned me into an author is the fact that March means winter, you're out of here. Now, I know we've had a pretty mild winter in New York City, relatively speaking. Only one day did we have any measurable snowfall. But as far as I'm concerned, one day is one day too many. So I'm very happy that winter's on its way out. Not to say that spring can't have cold and chilly days, but I mean, if we're having 50 degree weather in February, I think it's fair to say that we're in for a nice, hot, steamy spring and summer, and I'm excited.
Oh, dear God, I hope not.
Hey. Well, I don't know. The mics, they're wrong. Jesus Christmas. Can we hurry? Yeah, one of the mic cords dropped. But yeah, I love summer. I love heat. Dre, you were born in the summer.
Yeah, I was born in the summer. Don't mean I like it. I could tell you that right now.
I guess.
But there are some things about the summer. I mean, come on now.
Oh, God. It's probably going to be something crude that you're going to say.
Oh, man, you act like you haven't said worse than me on the show. At least I didn't talk about other stuff.
Yeah. And I mean, last week, Paul really showed his face, among other things, huh? I learned a new word, which is oversharing. I don't even like. Are these mics? What's these mics?
I thought I heard him.
Kevon's mic is not really. Is it on, Kevon?
Yeah, am I on?
No, I don't hear him.
I don't know. Paul is just—he's too busy.
My man's
oversharing. I don't know. Kevon, speak again. Yeah, it's just things are happening.
Okay, I see.
But anyway, so I didn't know what oversharing meant, but clearly Paul put me onto what oversharing is. He says I overshare.
Right, I would think you'd be well acquainted with that word.
Well, you know what?
What?
Let's give a great example of what that is.
What?
Harry probably sitting at home, butt ass naked as he does, wondering when someone is going to invite him to the function. Yeah, he's on TV and radio, and always busy, but never too busy for a party. So I gotta get this off my chest right now. Think of Carrie the next time you throw that banger.
Carrie gets so lonely. Why won't you invite him to your parties or your cookout? You know, he's the chillest. Carrie gets so lonely. just need somebody to hold him in his apartment where he's probably butt-ass naked. I should've known this, but he overshares. Carrie gets so lonely. Why won't you invite him to your parties or your cookout? You know he's the chillest. Carrie gets so lonely. Just need somebody to hold him in his apartment where he's probably butt-ass naked. I should've known this, but he overshared.
I hear Carrie got that new penthouse view in the only borough nobody wants to come through. Left Bean Town, yeah, now we trashing them daily. Only listen to music if it was made in the 80s. Pauly Hot Pockets, really bout that action. This one's for Carrie, so I'm rapping over Janet Jackson. Ay, I swear, this has been 10 years in the making. Yeah, we coming for the top, no mistaking.
Carrie probably sitting at home, butt ass naked as he does, wondering when someone is gonna invite him to the function. Yeah, he's on TV and radio, and always busy, but never too busy for a party. So I gotta get this off my chest right now. Think of Carrie the next time you throw that banger.
Oh my god.
Masterful.
What the hell did I do to deserve that ish?
You overshared. You overshared.
Yeah, you overshared. I shouldn't have known that stuff.
I mean, you know
it
what?
It doesn't mean you have to repeat it and then, for the love of God, make a song out of it.
It was kind of a banger, though. I'm not going to lie.
You know what? Hey, Paul, I'm going to need that. I have an idea. No. You know what?
We're not doing remixes here.
I don't need the remix.
But did you like the you like the sample at least, right? The Janet Jackson sample?
Are you asking me my opinion on your song?
You know, it's crazy. Auto-tune can make anyone sound good.
Well, we already know that.
Yeah, I know.
But Jesus Christ, I don't know. Your mic's not on. They can't even hear you yet. Well, our guest Jose has some opinions, but we'll definitely wait. Nobody's excited to hear the review of that travesty. But I guess, I don't know, Paul, is that an early birthday present? I mean...
Yeah, it's a 10-year, like, you know, ode to the show.
To the show.
You know what? A good rewrite. We could use that. I mean, you know, yeah. Maybe, well, instead of the roasting of Mr. Singleton, we could do something.
Yeah, the only roasting Mr. Singleton does is roast chicken, and I don't cook it. I just eat it. Anyway, I thought to myself, well, if nothing else, I guess the social media team would probably make a really cute, if not risque, video.
I feel like we should make a music video.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah. In your apartment, you know?
That's just not going to happen. You're totally not invited. Because I'll be butt-ass naked. So why would you...
Need a body double.
Yeah.
You said bucket naked.
Anyway... Okay, that's enough. Everybody got their jollies off, including our guests. Last week Wednesday, Allison, Gordon, and Kevon went to hang out at Kiara Sheard's record listening party. You guys need to grab a mic because I need opinions. How was that event? We'll start with you, Kevon, because I'm assuming you're closest to a mic. You need a mic, Allison. Just grab our guest's mic.
Yeah, so that event was actually really cool. I don't listen to much gospel music myself, but I do love live music, and Kiara Sheard was just awesome to talk to. Did a little interview with her, and that was, I mean, it was great. She's so, like, warm and welcoming, and she's doing EDM gospel music. I've never even heard of that, but that was, it was fun. It was really cool.
Okay. And Allison, was that your first listening party? You got to get the mic up, though.
Yeah, it was my first listening party. I thought it was really cool, though. I mean, I'm not, like, into gospel music like that, but like it kind of like changed my opinions on a lot of stuff,
because
what Kevon said, it was like EDM, it was a bunch of different styles, and I was like, that's really dope. I didn't realize that gospel music can go into like genres like that.
Yeah, it looked like you guys had a really good time. And Gordon, what was your opinion on Miss Kiara Sheard's event?
Is my mic okay? It was a really great event. She makes amazing music. It's cool seeing her work in a variety of different genres applied to gospel. and you know, it's, I really dig it. She cares about her artistry and shows.
Yeah, I didn't get to see the event because I wasn't present, but it definitely seemed as if she was very warm, very welcome. She gave us a 10-year anniversary shout out, which I thought was pretty cool. Yeah. And keep on, you did a really great job of interviewing her on the red carpet. I'm a little like nervous. I was kind of hoping you wouldn't come in today. I think you're trying to steal my job.
Thank you, man.
But just be willing, though, you know what I mean, to have your intern turned engineer slash producer years later want to make songs about you like Kerry Gets Lonely.
I'm not ready.
Yeah, well, I wasn't either. But what we all should be getting ready for is the fact that the Kerry's Corner Radio Show is celebrating 10 years of the Kerry's Corner Radio Show on April 1st at Stewart Cinema and Cafe in the Greenpoint section of Brooklyn. The address is 79 West Street. It is a private party, which means you can't get in without a ticket. Tickets are free, but you must have a ticket. Do you want a ticket? Do you want to come to the event? Do you want to come into the event and parlay with the likes of Mr. Cox, myself, Gordon, Allison, Kevon, just in time. I'm going to leave you last, Paul. Andre Jones and the rapper Paul ED. Then come check us out. Make sure you get your tickets. Tickets can be obtained via Eventbrite, but you got to get the link, and the link is on our social media. I think I just touched this microphone again with my lips. God, I hope I don't get like some things. But again, that's going to be April 1st, 2023. Doors open at 5 o'clock. The film, which will be debuting, is called Kerry's Corner, A Decade Behind the Music. That film is being produced and directed by D20 Pictures. A cake cutting ceremony and champagne toast will follow promptly after that. Then you're going to get the hell out. Anyway, doors open to 5, you guys. The tickets are mandatory. At 6 o'clock, we'll be starting the film. If you're not in the building, I'm going to say this because you know how people are. If you're not in the building by 5:45, we may actually ask you to stand outside until the film's over. Because we don't want people walking in while we're showing the documentary. So please, please, please get there at 4:45 where you may get denied entry. So make sure you get your tickets and make sure you're there at 5 o'clock p.m. What you doing with your fingers, Paul? I have a clock here. Today's Kerry's conversation topic is, and you're gonna have to explain this to me, Kevon, because you've got these scientific, technical things.
Use a funny word.
Yeah, I don't know what this. Yeah, cryptid. I don't know what that means. So the question, the Kerry's conversation topic, we'll start with you, Kevon, since this is your question. Have you ever seen or encountered a ghost, cryptid, or UFO? What is a cryptid? I mean, I can use context clues, but what is a cryptid, and then answer your question.
Right. So a cryptid is just me referring to something that's like paranormal. Like a Bigfoot, okay, or a Mothman.
You couldn't have just said paranormal like figure, huh?
Not, people call them cryptids. I didn't make it up.
That's Brooklyn Tech in your life.
I
that's
guess
what
so.
That is. Yeah. So have you ever seen or encountered a ghost, cryptid, or UFO?
All right, so for a lot of my life, I actually was very open to cryptids and stuff existing. I'm very scientifically minded, so I've always thought, like, maybe there's stuff out there we don't know. So I did, like, in upstate New York or whatever, go out thinking I was looking for Bigfoot. There was, you know, there might have been a big hairy guy out there, but he wasn't Bigfoot, I'll tell you that much.
Yeah, I'm sure if you go to Syracuse or Albany or Rochester or Buffalo, there's probably a lot of people that look like Bigfoot.
Right.
You know, all that interbreeding and stuff.
I never found him.
I don't like upstate, so I don't care. We're not syndicated up there, so I really don't care. Anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, but
Bigfoot's upstate.
Yeah, I thought that I was looking for him, but never found him. But as far as a ghost, my Nana actually thought, she was convinced that she had seen a ghost in our apartment, the very one that I live in now. She said that there was an old Jewish man as a ghost, that she saw him, and I heard that story so many times. Always an old Jewish man. And, yeah, for a lot of my childhood, that story.
Well, you live near Yankee Stadium, so he must have died a long, long time ago, bro.
Historic.
He's probably not hanging around 161st Street and River Avenue right about now.
Yeah.
Okay. Paul Dorsa, the new rapper.
Nah.
Who proves, once again, anybody can be successful in hip-hop.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Have you ever seen or encountered a ghost, cryptid, or a UFO? I already know the answer because I just know you, but what's your answer?
I have not encountered one.
No surprise.
But I have been watching The Vampire Diaries lately, and it's a pretty good show. I think I'd rather be a vampire than a werewolf because they can live forever, and they're kind of got like that mysterious vibe to them.
Has absolutely nothing to do with the question.
Yeah, they're cryptids.
Entire tangent.
Have you ever seen or encountered?
I've seen them on the show.
Yeah, okay. See vampires every week.
Is anybody getting his face? Somebody needs to get his face. We've already seen his ass last week with the McDonald's tattoo. But let's see the face. The face of blankness.
Oh, my God.
Andre Jones.
I done seen many things but Christ, but I have no clue about any of that stuff. I mean, I've heard of it, but I ain't seen nothing personally. I wouldn't doubt that there's stuff out there, like spirits and whatnot, but hey, I ain't seen nothing.
Okay, my answer is no. I have not encountered a ghost. Cryptid or UFO. I'd like to see a UFO. I don't know about a ghost though. Although I don't know, in my dreams I feel like that a lot of times those that have passed on, mm-hmm. they come back in my dreams, but I guess that wouldn't necessarily be a ghost because they're not like in a tangible situation. So I guess the answer to your question, Keevan, is no. I would like to see a UFO though, because I definitely, unlike Paul Dorsa, I am convinced that we are not the only intelligent life form that was created. At least I'll say this. I hope with all of my heart that we weren't. Because if this is the best that the creator could do, humans, Jesus.
Well, yeah, we're a side project.
The ocean, which is like, you know, 80% unexplored.
I mean, I know, but I mean, like, you know, the most intelligent things in the ocean, at least that we know of, are octopi and killer whales and dolphins and things and whales.
The gangsters of...
Right, but I mean, they can't, like, they can't build skyscrapers and subways and make iPods and stuff like that. iPods.
Oh, wait, no. Yeah.
So, I guess based on our narrow perspective, they're not as intelligent as we are. Although they seem to be living a more peaceful existence than we are. But maybe the point is that I really hope that on some other life inhabiting planet that there is a form of life that's far more intelligent than us and that just doesn't want to be bothered because they just have no reason to want to be bothered. That's my story. Let's get into these New Jacks here on Kerry's Corner, your new home for throwback New Jacks and oversharing.
Hey, yo, what's happening? This your boy, 5 Mics. Anytime I'm looking for great entertainment or the latest scoop on the music industry, I pick up Intrigue Magazine. Because everything I read in it is so intriguing. Don't believe me? Then find out on your own. IntrigueMagazine.com, where reading is a pleasure.
And now it's time for those exclusive New Jack joints right here on Kerry's Corner, your new home for throwbacks and New Jacks.
Hi, this is Dr. Reba Perry from Diva Dynasty Magazine, and congratulations on your 10 years at Kerry's Corner.
Trust in my heart and meet me in paradise.
Now is the time.
Girl, you're every wonder in this world to me. A treasure tied, I won't steal away. Yeah.
my name is Egypt Ufule, CEO of Chubby Line and Bully Chasers, and I'm here supporting Carrie's Corner. Happy 10-year anniversary.
Cold Jam, yo, Carrie's Corner, 10 years working it, making a scene happen. Thank you.
This one might be different. I may say, come down, my selector.
The more you live, the more you learn.
Now that the table turned, the most I rules and reigns. The most I rules and reigns.
Constitution states, hey, let me have my plate, hey, you already ate, yo, let me have my day, bro, fill it up with pesos, know them dead prezzies on board, I'm here to take those, everybody lay low, don't move till I say so, step out of line, guaranteed you'll meet the Draco, no need to act tough, when you know you solve the state though, I spray the whip up, uh-oh, get bingo, let's keep it real for a minute, you all fake though, I dress you up real nice, put on his halo, I watch them all break fast, Lego my ego. Send your soul to a place your body can't go. Yeah, I'm getting real money, you getting Play-Doh. I put the pieces together, I'm on my Lego. Yeah, yo, I'm the boss of what I say, go. I'm about to break, yo, get the yeah, yo.
King, make them bow down to their knees.
stepping. I don't need your direction. All I need is a session to receive a new blessing. Do it all with perfection. Now let me learn you a lesson. Level up every day. The boy move with progression. So I don't need your aggression. All I need is this lesson. Brand new out the box. I can't wait to start testing. So watch what come out your mouth. In the way you address it. Cause Lord knows I don't got the time to confession. Man, I think when I move, they'll slide like a chest. Got a problem with me? Get it off of your chest. Only focus on I. I don't care what the rest is. Eat all of the beef. Still trying to digest it. The rate I'm going, can't nobody stop me. You just a gesture. I'm bringing you the hard copy. Yeah, I know I'm cocky. These Joes do it all sloppy. 6'1", a little stocky. Make your own rock. I'm king.
King. Make them bow down to their knees. We're talking about a king. They praise us to love us like we're in these streets. Oh, king. Don't have to see it to believe it. The prophet spoke about it. The rising of a king. His ass friends. Watch me just run up in your heavens. And I'm not a preacher, but I'm here to teach you. Coming to your speaker, the most high words explode like bomb. One loaf of bread feed half a million. Life is just to leave your silly man. Boy, so when it comes to feel me, give me mine, oh yeah.
What up, y'all? It's your boy Ray Royale, Mr. I Am R&B. I want to send a special shout out to Kerry's Corner. Happy 10th anniversary. Kerry, you know I love you, man.
going on? This is Sean Rivera from As Yet, wishing Kerry's Corner Radio Show a happy 10th anniversary.
When we first met, we had a thing that was everlasting. So much of vibe, I knew we were two of a kind. One look in your eyes tells me every little thing you have in mind. Let's go somewhere private where we can unwind, 'cause I've got something planned for us tonight.
Put it where you want it, baby.
Put it where you want it, baby.
I love it when you moan my name. Crave it when you show no shame. Make me feel some kind of way. Don't you worry about a thing, 'cause I've got something planned for us tonight.
Put it where you want it, baby.
Put it where you want it, baby.
Put it where you need it. Beat it up and eat it. And I'll listen and repeat it, baby.
Listen and repeat it, baby.
Tickle it and tease it. Girl, you're undefeated, I'm gonna put it where you want it, baby.
Put it where you need it.
Okay, we're back on the Kerry's Corner Radio Show, celebrating almost 10 years on air. So excited to be celebrating with you guys. Again, make sure you get your tickets for the Kerry's Corner Radio Show's 10th anniversary party. It'll be taking place on April 1st, 2023, 5 o'clock sharp, you guys. Sharp. Watch people filing at 6 saying that they didn't know that I said 5. 5 o'clock, the doors open at the Stewart Cinema and Cafe in Greenpoint, Brooklyn. The address is 79 West Street. And we will be showcasing the new documentary, Kerry's Corner, A Decade Behind the Mic. We will be having a cake cutting ceremony. We'll also be having a champagne toast. You'll be able to meet all of us here at the Kerry's Corner Radio Show. And who knows, maybe Paul Dorsa will perform his latest hit, Kerry Gets Lonely. No, wrong answer. Anyway, you just heard from our New Jack segment, new music by Troop. They did a wonderful rendition of Lady in My Life by Michael Jackson from his Thriller album. All the way from Chicago, Illinois, one of my favorite cities in the entire world, Illinois. Not Illinois, Illinois. Jennifer, she calls that one the humming song. So, so beautiful. Such a beautiful song. Humphrey Bogart out of Connecticut, the Constitution State, which is where Paul laid down the locals for that damn song. He calls that one King. Ray Royale out of Boston, where they are getting their green shamrock asses kicked on the basketball court. He calls that one lonely. I could say ass. It's not really a swear anymore. Yeah. And they're getting their asses kicked. Yeah, the Celtics are getting smacked, which is why Paul and I are wearing our Knicks caps today. And last but not least, Sean Rivera out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He calls that one giggity. Make sure you guys check out the video. It's pretty interesting, to say the least. Shout out to Sean, formerly of As Yet. Pretty dope singer in his own right. Okay, I'm really, really excited. I have the honor of bringing in a gentleman that I met NYC Live at Fashion Week last month in February. Kevon, myself, Gordon, and Allison were in the building. And something to be said, we really respect photographers in here because, of course, Mr. Cox has been on the show the longest, 9 years, and he's a very well-respected and well-loved photographer, which is why, Jose, to be honest, I was actually kind of afraid to invite you to come in because he's a photographer lion. Your mic's on.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, yeah. He's a photographer lion. He's kind of, you know what I mean? He's like really intense. Like if he had been at the event that day, he would have been front and center in the pit, just controlling everything. He's like a monster behind that pit. But how long have you been doing photography?
I've been doing it for about a year now.
Oh, okay, so you're what Mr. Cox would probably call a newbie.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So, Mr. Cox, can you show him that camera really quickly? Just Jose, if you could turn around really quickly. So you see the camera, Jose, right? Okay, turn back around, Jose, because we got to hear you on the microphone.
Of course.
Do you have a camera, like, what kind, in terms of cameras, is that the mother of cameras? Like, how does that, and be careful, because he's very territorial.
It definitely has a nice body. I like how
It has
a nice Canon.
The camera has a nice body.
Yeah, it's got a nice Canon on it.
It has a nice what?
The Canon frame, it's okay. A nice body for the
like, it doesn't have a nice ass or anything, does it? Like, boobs? Sorry, Allison.
All the parts come together to create a badass camera.
He's on the wrong show to be saying this stuff. So, Mr. Cox, and your camera's name is, what is your camera's name?
Monique.
So, it's wow. Like, could you see the camera like in a two-piece or a one-piece? Is she wearing any drawers? Sorry, Allison.
It's like a robot. Camera's like a robot. The body itself, yeah. All the parts come together to create its masterpiece.
Yeah, that's your story. You're sticking to it. What got you interested in photography?
I had a headshot photographer who was doing the headshots for me. His name is Alonzo.
Wait, you were the subject?
I was the subject.
Okay, he was taking your pictures.
Yes.
Okay.
And he had me help him on some of his shoots, and he said that I had a really good eye and I should try it out.
Okay.
So I did, and more people were telling me you should actually try this for a living.
Okay.
So I actually bought a camera and started giving it a shot, and I developed a business, formed my LLC.
Okay.
And I started doing events, and I'm getting more and more business, and I love how the growth is happening. The more people I meet, the better my company's looking, because I'm taking care of it the way I want it to happen myself. I'm taking control and doing all the personal things for the business.
What's the most interesting is not the word that I want to use. What's the most interesting type of shoot that you've done? Have you done porn? I always listen, brother. You're not the first person. Anytime anybody's ever been on this show that's a photographer or a videographer, I want to know if you've ever done porn, because that's, I mean, we've had a porno star, former porno star, on this radio show. And then Mr. Cox takes a picture of me while I'm saying that. So have you done porn?
I can't discuss that. I'm sorry.
You can't discuss it?
No, I'm sorry.
It's either a yes or no.
I can't. I'm silenced by an NDA. I'm sorry.
That sounds like a yes to me. I'm just gonna assume. Okay, wow. Usually the answer is no, and I get bored and I trail off to another topic, but you don't want to. Okay, fine. Is there any kind of photography that you would not do?
Porn.
But you did porn.
I'll shoot it. I won't be in it. I won't start.
Well, no, of course not. Because you've already done porn, right?
I can't say
I'm trying. I was trying to do my Charlemagne there. Weddings, have you done weddings?
I haven't, but that is on my list. I would like to do that next.
Now this is something that Mr. Cox has been the lead photographer here on the Kerry's Corner Radio Show, the director of photography, actually, for 9 years. And one thing that he doesn't have a microphone, so I can say this. I feel like when it comes to landscapes, specifically skyscrapers and buildings, because that's what I like to take pictures of. I mean, I'm not a photographer, but I like taking pictures of city skylines. I don't know. I kind of feel like I can give Mr. Cox a run for his money.
landscaping,
he says no. Landscaping?
Yeah.
Because that's where I'm going. Like, is it for you? What do you prefer? People, animals, or natural beauty?
I like natural settings like mountains, streams, oceans, buildings, landscapes, like the cityscapes.
Yeah.
It's fascinating to me. I love shooting that.
And we live in a place, you know, here in the New York, you're from Newark, New Jersey.
Yeah.
Like, we live in a city where, I mean, I'd say, like, we have such beautiful vistas. I'm honestly going to say, as much as I love my adopted hometown of New York City, I'm going to say this. I think I might have said this once before. I'm not going to say that New York City is the most beautiful city to photograph in this country. I can't say that. Kevon, can we get a microphone for Kevon? Kevon, I bet you, without a doubt, you can guess what city I nominate as being the most beautiful to photograph.
It's going to be Chicago?
It's absolutely Chicago. It's absolutely. I mean, to be on Lake Michigan and get a picture of the Chicago skyline, I'm sorry, Manhattan. Manhattan's a close second, but when it comes to cities, have you been to Chicago, Jose?
I have driven through there once.
Oh, that's not. Yeah,
it's not really.
You got to get out. You got to get out. It's a beautiful city.
Yeah.
So a year in, and already you're doing Fashion Week.
Fashion Week events, Winter Film Festival.
You're right, the Winter Film Festival that you took. Well, you was there with Kevon.
Yes.
So let's first talk about the Fashion Week event that I met you at NYC Live at Fashion Week. Shout out to William Michael Reed. Was that your first Fashion Week event?
It was. Yes.
Okay. And
I was really upset that I didn't get there sooner to get in a nice position in front of the stage. But it was really great.
Well, Mr. Cox would say you gotta make it happen. You gotta elbow your way in. But you'll be there, I'm sure, in September.
Yes.
Yeah. So you'll get to you'll get to elbow your way in there. What are some of the things about Fashion Week that you like to photograph? Was it the candid shots of the people milling around, or was it the actual models?
The models were a great thing to do for the event, because that's what it's for.
Right.
But when they weren't walking down the runway, my most fascinating part was the people around it during the entire event.
Yeah.
The behind the stage things, meeting Carrie at the backdrop.
Yeah, he's a nice guy.
He is, of course.
With the Winter Film Festival, what was that like?
It was an indie festival here in New York City, and all these film artists and producers, directors, they were there to promote their films and give it a whole global stage. And giving them the camera, putting them on screen was the focal point, like giving them the stage for their moment, just so they can get a platform to build from. And I love doing that for them and being the part of having them build their growth. I don't really want the recognition. I want them to have the growth. So that's why I was.
Kevon had said when he came back to the radio show afterwards that he had a great time, and that there were models that, I guess there was one model who's
in a winter theme. Yeah. Oh no, who was attached to the red carpet.
Yeah. Oh, the living
carpet. That was a stunning dress.
The living carpet. Yes.
Yeah. So I wanted you to Kevon, since you were at that event, to ask Jose a question about that event specifically.
Okay, specifically about that event. So there was a lot of like high fashion, like very interestingly dressed people at that event. So is that something that you're interested in capturing, like just people communicating, like, you know, just people looking elegant in everyday situations?
I definitely like the people who look elegant and interesting, but the one that I want to capture the most is the one who want the attention by making themselves stand out the most.
Okay.
Somebody wearing something really interesting to catch your eye.
There was one model there that had like glowing wings on her outfit and like a winter theme with the crown, and that was definitely eye catching. I saw a lot of photos of that.
She was a living snowflake. Snowflake. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
In this political climate, that's kind of a weird thing to say.
Exactly.
I just caught that.
So she looked awesome.
What are some of the things that you'd like to photograph? So events, I would say, in the future.
I'm actually going to be in Washington, D.C. this coming weekend for the Lux film. It's a fashion show.
Okay.
But it's like a model competition.
Will the cherry blossoms be blooming? No, probably not, right?
Not next week.
Not yet,
but
okay.
In April, beginning weekend of April, it will be. And I'm going to try to be down there for that.
Okay.
I'm also going to try to be back in Newark for it, because the Cherry Blossom Festival and Brentwood Park is pretty big. The biggest cherry blossom population is in Newark, New Jersey.
Really? In Branch Brook? That's a tongue twister. Branch Brook Park. Really? Yes. I didn't know that. I thought it was in D.C.
No, that's the largest in the country is in D.C. The largest in New Jersey is in Newark. In
Newark, okay.
And the second largest is in Orlando, Florida.
Okay, wow, okay. We definitely want you to come back to the show. But before you leave, if there's two famous people that you could photograph, living or dead, one male, one female, let's go with the female first. Who would it be? I mean, it could be Princess Diana. It could be Madonna. It could be Janet Jackson. 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 Who would you like to photograph to do an entire photo shoot, a female?
Photo shoot for a female. I'm sorry, I have to say Tina Turner.
Hey, man. Yes.
She's a fantastic singer. She had a really complicated past, and she developed into such an amazing singer and songwriter. And I give her so much respect for getting to where she's gotten to.
Male?
Don't hate me, anybody in the world, but I'm pretty sure they will. Barack Obama.
Okay. Why would I hate you?
No, not you. Oh. Anybody in the world, they probably could, but I think Barack Obama is one of the most fascinating presidents that we've had in history.
Mm-hmm.
He's the first black president outside of Bill Clinton.
Bill Clinton was not black. He might have been from Arkansas and liked fried chicken, but he was not black. But yeah, I could see that. Yeah, like, because he's a very... What's the word that I'm looking for? Well, refined individual.
Barack?
Yes.
Yeah, he's
so
refined. He's got the drive in him to do something that changed the world, and he did.
Right.
And it's fascinating to capture somebody that captivating to the world, and I want to get that someday. I don't think I ever will, but
Listen. I said the same thing about meeting Patrice Rushing, who's my second favorite artist. I don't want to say second, but one of my favorite artists next to Janet Jackson. And I got to meet her last week and spend time with her and shake her hand and give her hugs and stuff. Anything that you want to make happen, you can make it happen. I'm living proof of that. I mean, I never wanted somebody to make a song about me, but look what Paul did, right? Thanks, Paul.
I really do appreciate coming on the show. Thank you, Karen.
How can people... Wait a minute. We can't let you go without letting people know how they can reach out to you if they want to hire you for photography.
I have a website called www.nimblejoe.com. Like Jack be Nimble, it's nimblejoe.com.
You can Nimble Joe. Isn't that what they call the current president?
That's Slow Joe. I'm the opposite.
Oh, okay. Nimble Slow Joe. Joe. Okay. Well, God bless him. I think he had like a cancerous tumor.
I don't know.
I don't bother.
I'm also on Instagram at Nimble Joe Photos. So not a big variation, but Nimble Joe Photos on Instagram.
And now on your Instagram page, do you have like a lot of your work?
I do have some of my work, and okay. I do need to update it and slam some things that I've done in the past few weeks. My website has a new gallery that I'm putting up constantly, new things. Instagram, I'm building and growing that with all the things I'm doing as it goes.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for hanging out with us. Don't go anywhere. We got photo shoots and all kinds of other great stuff. But before I stop talking, I have to talk about this week's artist spotlight artist. Actually, not one person, it's a family. The DeBarge family was composed of several members of... Well, DeBarge was composed of several members of the DeBarge family, in addition to various solo projects completed by members of the family. DeBarge was active between 1979 and 1989. The group originally consisted of L, Mark, Randy, Bunny, and James joined the group a year later for their second album. Bobby DeBarge and Chico joined in 1987 and 1988 respectively, replacing Bunny and L. DeBarge released 6 studio albums, 4 of them with Motown subsidiary Gordy Records. These albums included The DeBarges, 1981, All This Love, My Favorite, in 1982, In a Special Way, 1983, and Rhythm of the Night, in 1985. The latter became the group's best-selling album and contained the single Rhythm of the Night, which actually hit number 3 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100, making it their highest-charting single in America. In the mid-1990s, L and Buddy and Bunny DeBarge each went solo, and DeBarge was subsequently released from their contract. But between the individual DeBarge records the group albums, and of course Bobby's work with his group. I can't think of their name. That's terrible. they've given us such great music. And right now, we're going to celebrate the DeBarge family here on Kerry's Corner, your new home for throwbacks and new jacks.
Hey, y'all. We are the Brown Boutique. We specialize in handmade, customized candles, T-shirts, and more. Whether it's for a lost loved one you want on a candle, a birthday, holiday, or a party, you name it, we got you for all of your customized needs. Check us out on Instagram at @TheBrownBoutique_ and be sure to follow us to stay up to date on new products. The Brown Boutique, where sense makes sense. Now check out these exclusive jams on Kerry's Corner, your new home for throwbacks and new jazz.
Hey, what's up, y'all? Just kick back, relax, and listen to this week's Artist Spotlight.
Quite a while.
some problems, and no one could seem to solve them. But you found the answer. You told me to take this chance and learn the ways of love, my baby, and all that it has to offer. In time,
time it will reveal. so very.
When it feels like the world is on your shoulders and all of the madness has got you going crazy, it's time to get out, step out into the street where all starting under the street lights, the scene is being set. A night for romance, a night you won't forget. So come join the fun, this ain't no time to be staying on. Ooh, there's too much going on. Oh, tonight is gonna be a night like you've never known. We're gonna have a good time the whole night long. Oh, feel the beat of the rhythm of the night.
Hey, it's Mike Shannon, and you're listening to Club Classics on Kerry's Corner.
Get the point? Good. Let's dance.
Feel a shadow over my head. I feel a shadow.
Take that to the bank. I know how to treat a man when you're in the hands, baby.
And we're back on the Kerry's Corner Radio Show. Just got out of a Club Classics mix, courtesy of DJ Justin Time. Shout out to DJ Justin Time for making a dope mix. I'm here with my big brother from another mother, all the way from White Plains, New York, up in Westchester County. What's up, brother? How you been?
What's good? What's good? I'm Mal Vernon. He's White Plains.
Oh, God. Lower Westchester.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay. Yes.
Damon is from White Plains.
Yes.
You are from money earning Mount Vernon.
Yes, yes, sir.
Heavy
yes, sir.
D.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Albie Shore.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Pete Rock and CL
Smooth.
Pete Rock and CL Smooth.
Yes,
the
yes,
great.
Yes.
Yes, indeed. Welcome back to the show. Damon didn't bring no cupcakes, so he gets no airtime at all. Tell your wife I said hello. No shade.
Yeah, I let her know,
but
man.
Yeah,
I let her
know. I say that because she makes the cupcakes that you never seem to bring. Talk to me about this new book project you're doing. You got, Black Westchester celebrates Black Women of Westchester, which is perfect, AJ, because this is, of course, Women's History Month, March. And now let's talk about that. What the... I love the covers. Look at all these beautiful Westchester residents. And I'm still single. Damn, did I say, oh, God. Ouch. What was the premise behind putting this book together?
Well, I did the first book and released it in June. And the first book was about how we got started. And I was telling Damon I was going to do a book for Black History Month, being that all the news we cover is Black history. We cover all the firsts as it is happening. So I had a lot of that stuff on the website, and I just wanted to put it together in one book.
Okay.
But as I started going on, you know, women have been doing the thing the last 5 years or so. So I just focused on women.
The last 5 years?
5-10 years. I mean, more.
Listen.
But more and more, yes, and more and more is the point I was
correct.
Making.
Yes, sir. Exactly.
And when you go back into their history, it was harder to find the achievement,
yes,
of African-American women going back further and further, which made me want to dig it and be the first one.
Only because it wasn't documented.
Right.
Right.
And so I wanted to document it. I wanted to be that person.
So is this a... Let me flip through this. Is this a pictorial or...
No. It's
oh, okay.
Yes.
Texts.
Yes, yes.
I like to read.
Yes.
I know a lot of folks nowadays don't like to read, but
no,
I like to read.
Absolutely not.
Damon's like, no.
Right.
I'm actually a reader. And these are big words. Did you print this for, because people like me are is this for the eye? Jeez, so, like, do you see how big, Paul?
So the real,
like,
the real,
damn,
the real
Stevie
story.
Wonder could read this.
The real story of that, on the first book, my daughter was laying it out for me, and she got a 14-inch screen. And the workspace was this big. I was like, people can't read them letters. So we made it big enough to read there. And when it came printed, we was like, wow, that's big. So we decided to leave it. But on this book, I brought it down a size, though.
Everybody said,
I don't need my glasses for this.
Look, bro.
These
are readers. Shout out to Vontel Eyewear. So these are readers,
right?
I take my readers off, and I can read this perfectly.
And that's why I did it. And that's why I left it that way.
I'm telling you, Ray Charles, God rest his soul, could have read this whole book. Helen Keller, too. He would. Shout out to Helen. She would have appreciated. That's shady, Kerry. Where did you get your content from?
150 different sources.
Of course,
our archives, because we covered a lot of it.
Yes.
But, you know, the police departments, the historical societies.
Okay.
Just everywhere. Even the Guinness Book of World Records. There's two women. They're the oldest authors. They were 103 and 105. They're sisters. They're in the Guinness Book of World Records.
The oldest published authors?
Yes, yes.
That's pretty dope.
So when I read that, you know, of course I had to go to Guinness and check it and make sure it was legit.
So what is Damon? Because I never see you two separate. I'm beginning to think you're like Siamese twins. Did Damon have anything to do with the publishing or the idea? Did he have anything to do with the book at all?
No.
No?
Okay. No, just support, man. That's
okay.
My dude, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we thought it was good because it just wasn't documented.
Right.
You know, Black history in Westchester, even though, you know, they say it's a racial equality county. There's a lot of racism.
Yeah,
you know,
that's everywhere.
And so we at Black Westchester, we try to document as much positive things that we can. And now since we're both into writing books, you know, in our own lane on writing books, it was a great idea to document the history of black women in Westchester County.
I like, you know, Italians in Westchester are doing their thing too. Paul Dorsa is Italian Westchester.
Oh, absolutely,
right, right, absolutely.
And he just, you didn't hear it because you weren't here, but he wrote a song and recorded about me, and it was quite interesting. So yeah, I think we should salute Italian Westchester.
There was one more thing though, if I can.
Yeah.
So we're in a time right now, if we want to be real, where they're whitewashing our history.
Absolutely.
And trying to omit our history.
Absolutely.
So okay. That's the point. Like, this is the first of a series of books documenting the achievements of African Americans in Westchester.
Okay.
I remember saying back in the days, I said, yo, we don't document our history, people are going to be saying 50 years from now, Vanilla Ice was the king of hip-hop.
Right.
And while everybody laughs, I said, imagine Little Richard and them having that conversation.
Yeah.
Saying, yeah, you know, they're going to say Elvis was the king of hip-hop, and that's what they're saying now.
Well, it's true because, yeah. I'm geographically familiar with Westchester County. And the only things I know about Westchester greatness, please don't beat me up for saying
this. Oh, no problem.
Would be like Mary J. Blige,
that's,
DMX.
That's
You know, well, I don't consider... Don't be shady, Kerry. It's 50 years of hip hop. Some people would think the Lox.
The Lox was from Westchester.
Yeah, I know, yeah. But some people would consider them greatness of Westchester. Me, not so much. Heavy D. You know, and I'm sure that there's a lot of great black Westchester history outside of music, and that's the point.
Right.
That's why I love the fact that you put this book together, that it illustrates the fact that there are other success stories out of black Westchester, aside from Uptown Records, for example.
Now you had people that know Ella Fitzgerald lived in Yonkers for a long period of time.
Oh, I didn't know that. Shut up.
Sojourner Truth lived in Briarcliff Manor.
Wow.
And there's a timeline at the end from going back to 1828 when Sojourner Truth was the first African-American to sue a white person and win.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? So,
well Madam C.J. Walker.
Madam C.J. Walker to live in Irvington years later. She built a big mansion. Yeah. So there's a lot of people. Betty Shabazz moved to Mount Vernon after Malcolm died.
Yes,
and
that I know.
A couple of doors down was Nina Simone.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? They're on the same block at the same time. You know what I mean? So,
yeah, you know. Westchester County definitely has... I love the fact that the two of you collectively definitely put the county on the map in terms of civil achievements and social achievements and political achievements. I love that. I mean, I need to know that there's great black history outside of the five boroughs of New York City,
absolutely.
In the lower New York State region.
Right,
you know what
right,
I mean?
Right, right, absolutely.
No, so that's a great thing. What's your next step though? Like, are we doing some book tours here? Or like,
well, I'm on a library tour now.
Nice.
I just did
that's dope.
I just did my 7th or 8th stop Saturday. Was the big one.
Okay.
And so we're running through all the libraries. I've spoken at a bunch of schools lately.
Okay.
So I'm doing all that, and I'm working on the next book right now.
Too. Oh, have you had the opportunity to get your book into any of the libraries in Westchester County?
Yeah, several of them. Well, everyone I've been to, they definitely brought it. But several of them are buying it, and, you know.
What are some of them so that we can let our listeners know?
Places like Ossining.
Ossining, New York, okay.
Port Chester, Peekskill.
Okay.
Greenberg.
Okay.
So I was Saturday, Mount Vernon, New Rochelle, Yonkers, Pelham.
Okay.
Yeah.
The only thing I know about Ossining is the jail.
The jail. Same thing.
Exactly.
So, well,
that's all they built a town around the jail. That's what it is.
There's a lot of them upstate. Were you able to go to the Ossining prison?
I didn't go to Ossining prison.
I think personally, no jokes.
Yeah.
I think it would be kind of dope if you're able to get into the prison and get the book in there and also speak to the guys.
Yeah.
That's something that I've found very fulfilling here in the five boroughs is speaking to the incarcerated. They like to read too.
Right.
They like to read too. Where do you see yourself going with the book in terms of what's your next mission in terms of, because you said you got another book coming out.
Well, yeah, I'm working on another book now, but this is a series of books that are going to be documenting. Of course, this didn't capture all the black women in Westchester, so there'll be a part 2 and part 3.
Okay.
The men of Westchester will be next February for Black History Month, but being the 50th anniversary, I'm going to cover hip-hop.
Okay.
I'm going to be, and that'll be out August 15th or something. So I'll be doing...
I was going to ask you, I don't mean to interrupt you. Yeah, were you going to do a follow-up for the fellas?
Yeah, the fellas, I'm going to put that out for Black History Month next year.
Oh, for next year.
Yeah,
2024.
So that's partially done already, but it'll come out for Black History Month. This came out just at the time, the intersection of Black History and Women's History Month, and it was like the perfect storm, literally. And so, with all the Black Girl Magic going on, it literally was the perfect storm.
So I'm going to ask you a question that I ask a lot of authors that come through here. Being an author myself, what was it like the day that you became an author? The day that you received your first copy of your book in the mail, what was that like for you, brother? Because I ain't going to front. I fell asleep in the bed with mine. No shade.
I was singing like that Method Man. It's real, son. It's really real, son. It's really real. Yes, it's really real.
Yeah, that's one thing.
It's real. Like, I can touch it. I can feel it. Like, it was, you know, seeing a picture of it. But when I got that first copy, I was like, yo, I was literally, he'll tell you, I was taking pictures. Yo, I got it. It's here.
I don't want to sound like a freak, but I smelled mine. Like, the smell. Because I like the smell of books, new, brand new books. I smelled mine. It was just, that's a dope, because from now on, the one thing that nobody can ever take from you is the title of author.
Absolutely. Right.
From now until forever, your A.J. Woodson is now an honorary member of the family of authors, and that's pretty dope.
And I added another title since I've been here, Journalism Fellow.
Okay, well, what does that mean?
I've had two fellowships at the Craig Newmark Graduate School of Journalism. So I am now a Journalism Fellow.
Okay.
And to be honest, my partner, Dr. Bob, that runs with us, he's a scholarly dude. I was like, yo, what's this fellow thing? He said, no, you got to put that on your resume. You got to put that everywhere. It's a big deal. Okay. So I am considered a fellow.
Well, congratulations. Now. And I know I've said that I'm coming up to Westchester, but it's been cold. Yes, I am going to come up there. but one thing I want to talk about right now is that hat you're wearing.
Yes,
because you're wearing the Knicks cap. I'm wearing my Knicks cap. Paul is the biggest Knicks fan of all time.
We took pictures of Knicks hats last time. I had the shirt on. I think we did a Knicks picture, me and him.
Well, see, I'm gonna give him the mic for a second, but I'm going to say this. So last week, you guys know where I'm originally from, right?
Yes.
Where?
I know, and I can't think of it because you said it.
Anyway, I'm originally from a city that I really don't like that much, and they recently had a guest that came from my hometown last week who came down and swore on their lives that their obnoxious, arrogant team
in Boston
would beat the Knicks, right?
And we, yes.
And Paul, because I'm going to keep it real. I'm not a sports fan. I really could care less. I just don't like any sports teams that come from Boston because they're Boston teams.
And that's a New York thing. I mean, that's a real thing.
It's a real thing, though.
But it's a real thing, though. Right? Since Babe Ruth, it's been a real thing on both sides.
So Paul let me know that the Knicks won when they went back to Boston. Last night,
double overtime,
and last week. So how?
They won twice in 6 days.
Yes,
I think they beat the Celtics 3 times this year. First time that's happened in a long time,
very long time.
So
since Patrick Ewing or something.
Yeah, I think so.
Wow, that little Shamrock must have a really sore ass right now. Exactly. All those spankings from the Knickerbockers.
Yeah, something is happening in New York. Something special.
Yeah. I don't think my mother would agree, and she likes you, Paul. But I think it's pretty special because I don't like the Celtics, the Bruins, the Patriots, the Red Sox, anything. Yeah. God. The Lobsters.
When the Nets came to Brooklyn, everybody's like, oh, it's all about the Nets. And the Knicks are showing that this is New York. This is our town.
As long as it's a New York team, I'm all for it. Yeah. Let everybody know how they can purchase copies of your book, AJ.
Both of the books are available on Amazon.
Okay.
Yes.
Let them know the titles.
So it's Black Westchester Celebrates Black Women of Westchester. And the first book is Black Westchester, The Origin Story.
Okay.
Basically, you know, I'm a superhero fanatic, so
I
had to give our origin story. You know, like all the superheroes have origin stories. I had to give our origin story, how we got started, how we built this thing, this great experiment 9 years later that they didn't think was going to be around.
And right.
It led us to 2 weeks ago being up in Albany talking to some legislators about some legislation.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, they didn't think we was going to be around.
And Damon, before I let you guys go, although I'm not sure, you didn't bring any cupcakes. Let everybody know how they can pick. You got 4 new books. You brought a whole new library.
Yeah, brother. I've been busy.
Yeah, you know? I appreciate it. I like
and
it.
And I got one more coming out.
You got another one coming.
In July.
So let everybody know very quickly what the titles are and how they can get copies of them.
So it's Eating Clean and Juicing to Live. Oh. It's the 53 building blocks to be a divine black masculine.
Okay.
It's Black Minds.
Oh, wait. Did you hear that title, Andre? Yeah, because he's... Yeah, what was the title? Say the title of the last book.
53 building blocks to be a divine black masculine.
Yeah, his face. moving on.
Black Minds Must Matter.
Uh-huh.
And The Strategies of Self.
Okay. And how can people pick up those books?
They could go to twostepublishing.com or they could go to Amazon.
Okay. Excellent. Excellent. Excellent, damn it. And as I celebrate on March 18th, the 10-year anniversary of my first
Congratulations.
Book.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
My first book, on March 18th, my first book, The Wanderer's Game,
okay.
Came out and made me an author. So I'm celebrating as you are.
Yes. God bless.
The newness
Definitely.
Of becoming an author. It's always a pleasure to have you guys
Absolutely.
On the show. Let me open this box, though, really quickly. Let me see. I know there ain't no cupcakes in here.
Nah, I'm not the cupcake guy. He's
I know,
the cupcake
but I'm just
yeah, yeah, he's just putting it.
Oh, see, now I got a mug that would be dope if I could put some hot chocolate in here and drink the hot chocolate while I'm eating
cupcake. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yes. Your wife's cupcake.
We went back to the cupcakes again. Yeah.
Without any further ado, let's get into some music here on Kerry's Corner, your new home for throwbacks and new jacks. Andre, what you got?
Hey, this is Kerry D. Singleton from the Kerry's Corner Radio Show, and you are in the mix with our DJ, Andre Jones.
I'm stronger than a locomotive. Yeah, that old saying is true. But I can't understand sometimes, baby, why I'm so weak for you. Listen, I can leap tall buildings in a single bound. When it comes to getting over you, baby, well, I can't get off the ground. But they call me the Superman lover, yeah. Say they call me the Superman lover, yeah. But something wrong with me to see.
I speak to myself sometimes, and I say, oh my, in a lot of ways you're a lucky guy, and oh, now all you need is a chance to try, and in love, and in my heart there's a need to shout, dying, screaming, crying, and let me out. Are all those feelings that I want to touch and in love? What a world for the lonely kind. Sometimes I feel I'm gonna lose my mind. Can anybody tell me just where to find any love, any love?
We'll be right back.
From the radio to the TV screen, anything you want, I'll ever need.